We're Lent, you know, we're counting down to Easter. We're not pretending there wasn't one. So I encourage you to sing. I love the singing of this congregation. Some of you sing without making a whole lot of noise, but I can still see your mouth. And remember, in the Anglican tradition, our songs are our prayers. We don't sing and then pray. So please do read along. We've got some beautiful music planned for you this morning. So thank you for coming.
Thank you.
Since we have a great high priest who has passed through the heavens, Jesus, the Son of God, let us with confidence draw near to the throne of grace, that we may receive mercy and find grace to help in time of need. Let us confess our sins against God, our neighbor, and ourselves.
And try to follow faithfully, but so often we get lost or turn away. We try to love our neighbors and ourselves, and even by your grace, to love our enemies as you call and empower us to do. But we fail. We take the wrong path and stray from the way of your love. Forgive us, Lord, and guide us back to you. Amen.
Almighty God, have mercy on you, forgive you all your sins through our Lord Jesus Christ, strengthen you in all goodness, and by the power of the Holy Spirit, keep you in eternal life. Amen. Amen.
Let's start that again.
Reading from the book of Genesis. The Lord said to Abram, leave your land, your family, and your father's household for the land that I will show you. I will make of you a great nation and will bless you. I will make your name respected and you will be a blessing. I will bless those who bless you, those who curse you I will curse. All the families of the earth will be blessed because of you. Abram left just as the Lord told him, and Lot went with him. Now Abram was 75 years old when he left Haran. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Let us read Psalm 121 responsibly, alternating at the asterisk. I lift my eyes to the hills.
From where does my help come?
My help comes from God,
the maker of heaven and earth.
God will not let your foot be moved.
The one who watches over you will not fall asleep.
Behold, the one who keeps watch over Israel
shall neither slumber nor sleep.
Holy One watches over you.
And is your shade at your right hand.
So that the sun shall not strike you by day,
nor the moon by night.
God shall persevere you from all evil.
It is the one who shall keep you safe.
God shall watch over your going out and your coming in.
From this time forth forevermore.
Reading from the letter of Paul to the Romans. So what are we going to say? Are we going to find that Abraham is our ancestor on the basis of genealogy? Because if Abraham was made righteous because of his actions, he would have had a reason to brag, but not in front of God. What does the scripture say? Abraham had faith in God, and it was credited to him as righteousness. Workers' salaries aren't credited to them on the basis of an employer's grace, but rather on the basis of what they deserve. But faith is credited as righteousness to those who don't work, because they have faith in God who makes the ungodly righteous. The promise to Abraham and to his descendants that he would inherit the world didn't come through the law, but through the righteousness that comes from faith. If they inherit because of the law, then faith has no effect and the promise has been canceled. The law brings about wrath. But when there isn't any law, there isn't any violation of the law. That's why the inheritance comes through faith, so that it will be on the basis of God's grace. In that way, the promise is secure for all of Abraham's descendants, not just for those who are related by law, but also for those who are related by faith of Abraham, who is the father of us all. As it is written, I have appointed you to be the father of many nations. So Abraham is our father in the eyes of God, in whom he had faith, the God who gives life to the dead and calls things that don't exist into existence. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Descended from heaven, the Son of Man.
And just as Moses lifted up the serpent in the wilderness, so must the Son of Man be lifted up, that whoever believes in him may have eternal life. For God so loved the world that he gave his only Son, so that everyone who believes in him may not perish, but have eternal life. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Christ.
Follow me. And Abram says yes. But then we get Psalm 121. If you look at the Psalm, it's very comforting. Maybe you could bring the bulletin home and read it later. When I look to the hills, from where comes my strength. So the first reading we hear says God calls you and he starts to go and he gets these promises. Psalm 121 comes in and reminds you that you don't walk alone. And then we have the epistle, and sometimes that's hard to connect. That's a different kind of writing than a psalm. That's a different kind of writing than the Old Testament history lessons. And what we hear there is, by the way, the reason Abraham was holy is not because he was circumcised or he was of a particular religion. He's holy because he had faith in the person that made him a promise. So just if you start thinking like, okay, I'm going to follow God somewhere, and then a psalm says God is with me, and then you realize I'm never really going to succeed because I'm what? I don't go to church enough, I'm not religious enough, I didn't study religion. Boom, the epistle comes in and says, just remember what made him a buddy of God. Faith. Okay, so that's reassuring. And then we get to the gospel. To Nicodemus. Now notice, we learn a lot in the first two sentences. The first is that he's a person of great prominence in the Israelite world. He's a Pharisee. Now, what you should know about Pharisees, if you just come to church all the time, you sort of hear this word, and my British friends, you know we have good guys and bad guys here? I love it. In England, you know what they're called? Any of you from the UK? They're called baddies. That's what they call bad guys. Baddies. And let's be honest, if you go to any normal church and you just sort of listen to, you know, kind of average preaching, the Pharisees are the baddies, right? I mean, they're never really the hero of any particular story. Well, they kind of get a bad rap, though, I gotta say. Here's what a Pharisee is. Before the Pharisees, who'd been around for about 200 years before Jesus, the belief was, you know, the temple that used to stand, you know, the one that now only has the wall, the Wailing Wall. So the temple back in the day, and then the temple before that, the belief was sacrifices could happen there, prayers could happen there, but only there. Does that make sense? Like, there's no, like, take it to go. There's no, like, have the same kind of holiness at home. You had to come. And remember, there's one temple for all of Israel. So Galilee, I mean, we're talking days of travel. So the Pharisees were this movement of people that said, what if we study all of the gestures and the movements and the hand washing and the prayers of the temple, and we do exactly what we did in the temple, maybe people can practice this holiness outside the temple. Do you see how, like, that's a good thing? These are people who were trying to spread temple worship into daily life. Now, what's sad is by the time we come to them, you know, the stories of Jesus, they're the ones running around telling everyone, you didn't wash your hands right. You're not allowed to do that outside the temple. You're not allowed to heal today. But do you see why? Because what they were saying is, look, this is a movement. We're trying to make a movement that's going to be accepted in our religion, that you really can, like, do a Eucharist at home or something. But oh my gosh, it'll fall apart if when you go out, you start doing it however you want. Does that make sense? So they wound up being kind of stricklers for, like, details. Because they were trying to keep this movement going, that as long as you did everything at home or on the street or in your fields that was done in the temple, you might have the same acceptance of God. Your sacrifice is accepted, your prayers heard. So they were very serious. But they were kind of on the leading edge of living your faith outside the one temple in the whole kingdom. So you see why Jesus, like, this wasn't going to go well. Because he says, of course, we're going to go out to the temple. And you've heard all the stories. Remember, Jesus says, like, it's not what's unclean that you eat that makes you unclean. It's like all those thoughts you have about your brother-in-law that listens to a different cable news station. That's what makes you unclean. You know, if you worried as much about your neighbor as you do about how many times you wash your hands, maybe you've lost your way. Remember, Jesus says the Sabbath was made for people, not people for the Sabbath. We weren't created to follow rules. We're given rules because when there's a speed limit, less people die. That a certain kind of limits are what lets us live abundant lives. A certain kind of vows you take to a religious order, to a spouse, to a community, to the court. That these vows are what actually let you then express yourself and trust that you won't be left alone or punished. So Nicodemus knows all this. So he's trying to figure it out. Jesus is trying to do what he's trying to do, bring faith to the people. But he's saying you don't need every single rule of the temple. That's upsetting, because if you're a Pharisee, that's your job to teach people that. That's like if you make typewriters cheering for the internet. But I do want you, if there's just one or two things you remember this morning, do remember, especially those of you who have Jewish friends, spouses, neighbors, do remember that because of the way we've talked about Pharisees, we've made Jews the baddies in almost every century. So take that in your pocket today as you leave, that it's not that the particular religious leaders, because that is the history at that time, does that make sense? We're participating in the death of Jesus. That's a fact. But what we know is most of them were corrupt. And Jesus was a threat to their money and their power, not to their religion. That's like taking politicians now and saying, well, they're doing what they're doing on behalf of, like, the Methodist churches, like, if that's what they happen to be. But do remember that there was something about even the Pharisees, and especially on Good Friday, we do not say good things about them. Remember, they had a project to spread the love of God outside of a building. And we have something in common with them. We disagree on Jesus, for sure. But not on the fact that we want the love of God to bathe the world, not just the buildings. But let's get back to Nicodemus, because he's our Lent person. He's going to show us how to do this. Because the other thing you learn in the first two sentences is it says Nicodemus came to Jesus at night, in the dark, what it technically says. That's a little sketchy. But of course he came in the dark. He's like totally the super Jewish person, leader in the neighborhood. So he goes to Jesus, but then look what he says. He says, Jesus, I've seen what you've done. You know, the lepers come with him, that have leprosy and are healed, the blind see. He's actually seen Jesus raise a child from the dead. He hasn't raised Lazarus yet, but that's coming. So he goes to Jesus and says, I have seen what you've done. Here's the problem. You're claiming to be God, and I can't go with you there. So Jesus starts over with him and says that he has to be born a second time. That what he's saying about the flesh is true, that people get healed and people can see, but he's inviting Nicodemus. And if you go back and look at that gospel and you read back and forth, Jesus isn't immediately helpful. He just keeps asking Nicodemus questions. But what he's saying to him is, look what you've already seen. I'm not asking you for blind faith. This is another thing to take home in your pocket today. Jesus doesn't ask you for blind faith. That's what the gospels are all about. When you take a couple of loaves and fish and you feed 5,000, that's not belief. Does that make sense if you were there? That's just happening in front of you. Now, believing Jesus is God, that's a belief. But watching people be healed. So I love that Nicodemus, like us, is in a time of darkness. Now, today's a beautiful day, but Lent usually comes into Western Christianity at the end of a period of winter, a period of darkness, even if it's not cold. And that's where we are now. And some of you may say, well, you know, we're not in darkness. It's a beautiful day outside. Look at the shadows. Patungsi Phil, or whatever that hedgehog, groundhog thing was. I don't even remember how that went, actually. I'm always afraid that he's going to drop it. Remember a couple years ago they dropped the thing? Do you know what I'm talking about? They killed him. Like, on live TV. I mean, you have one job, right? One job. But despite this light, I hope that we can agree that we are in a period of darkness. And for those of you who are like, if you're a visiting preacher, could you just like not say that? Like, you know. But here's the thing. Look at the news. There's the worst famine happening in different parts of Africa now in the last 200 years. And drought. And that's international news. You all know about the war in Ukraine, right? But what you may not know, according to the United Nations, when that war started a year ago, that's the 50th hot war in the world. Not Cold War. There are 50 wars right now in the world. Active wars. I know some of you are like, where was the, didn't you promise joy about 15 minutes ago? There is freedom in acknowledging the darkness. So of course we have a lot in common with Nicodemus, who goes to Jesus as we do every time we come to the Eucharist in the dark. Doesn't have to be night to be dark. Those of you with medical diagnoses, with unemployment, with illness, with chronic illness, which is some of the most, you know, invisible illnesses in the world. Strife in your immediate family, in your neighborhood, in your graveyard. There is darkness, and it isn't, I'm not asking you to believe me, just to look. And by the way, there's at least two other ways. If the Jesus way doesn't work for you, let's bracket that for a second. Let's take two other very common things people do to deal with darkness around us. You know, because let's just consider the alternatives. You ever been in a dark room where you go into a bedroom and you turn off the light and then you just start tripping on things, you stub your toe on the bed or whatever? And what does someone usually tell you to do? Well, there's always turning on the light, right? That's the smart person. I guess I had different college roommates. What they said was, just wait for a second, because what happens?
You get used to it.
This is terrible spiritual advice, people. Here's the thing. The reason people keep saying it is if you don't want to stub your toe and have it be like purple and yellow and prehistoric for the next month, you do want to wait to acclimate. You're not going to be able to see the color and the life and the beauty of that room, but you probably won't kick anything and get hurt. Let's be realistic, even in our own lives. This is a strategy that's more common than we want to admit. Rather than try to figure out or solve or respond or rebuke or advocate for light, we just try to get used to the darkness so we don't get hurt. We know it's not ideal. We know other people are suffering. But you don't want to stub your toe. So that's strategy number one. Very popular. Clicking on Amazon is part of it. Going into Whole Foods and having 81 flavors of cherry jelly is another. which is just get used to the darkness and find other things to do. Give up on the light. Okay, second is to deny the darkness. Do you all have a friend like this? Some people call this optimism. I don't find it optimistic. I'll say something like, gosh, I was in traffic for 2 hours in DC. They're like, could have been more. Okay? Gosh, I've got two friends with COVID, and they're having a really hard time with it. Person's like, yeah. Can you imagine if you like knew more people with COVID? I mean, well, actually more people have COVID, but not your people. You know, this is not optimism. It's not optimism that when you tell someone there's something wrong, they tell you it could be worse. I've got a mom, I love her to death. She's 85, she's way into this. Mom, it's pouring rain today. Maybe not tomorrow. but her life is mostly indoors at 85, so she gets to say that. That is just denying the darkness. It's also a strategy. I'll be honest, my mom's a pretty happy person, right? On the other hand, I asked her if she wanted to go see the Emmett Till movie. She starts crying. She's like, that's such a sad story, I can't see that movie. I was like, well, Mom, you might learn something. She's crying. So does that make sense? She's in the right place on the issue, but she's like, I don't want to see it. And of course, those of you know the Emmett Till story, that's like literally the point of the Emmett Till story, is to see something that you don't want to see. That's actually what that story is about. In fact, my mom, when she turned 85, declared to me she doesn't want to see any sad movies anymore. Any of them. So now when a movie comes out, I don't even ask her because she's just decided she doesn't, but she's 85. I'm not, you know, throwing my mom under the bus here on YouTube. But do you see her strategy? And I had a sister who died when I was young. My father died when I was 18. My mom has had a very hard life. I'm not going to lecture her now. But the bottom line is her strategy to just not watch the sad movies is not a sustainable strategy. It's her way of saying, I'm actually tired of the sad stories. So I respect her choice. But dare I say to you this morning, you're given a different choice than that. Not just to get used to the darkness and not just to say I'm 85 and I'm not going to movies anymore. Because you know what, if you watch the news, that's a lot worse than the Banshees of Inisherin or whatever. What we're meant to take away, I think, from the gospel this morning is there is a way through the darkness, and Nicodemus shows us how. Go to Jesus anyway. The world is dark, but go and ask your questions anyway. And you, like Nicodemus, the reason most of you are here, unless this is your first time here, you're here because something in your life, you saw something holy. You did. You saw the Eucharist heal you. You saw a prayer make someone feel better. You heard some music, and it literally was like the voice of God, despite that it was a third grade recorder concert, and you know. But it touched you. God can break through that. So you're like Nicodemus. We're not coming empty-handed. We have seen some things, but like him, we don't know what to do now. Because if I follow you, Jesus, further, my life has to change. That's what Nicodemus is saying. I can't just keep come seeing you in the evening when no one sees me. Sooner or later, I've got to walk into the world and follow you because you're going to get away from me, like literally back in the day, because he was literally there walking away from him. So that's your question this morning. Have you just seen enough and it is enough? Or do you want to keep going? Do you want to keep going? And you know the great thing we learn in the Gospel of John? Nicodemus does keep going. Spoiler alert. I haven't read the Bible yet. Remember what happens at the end of Jesus' life. Joseph of Arimathea and Nicodemus are the ones that take him off the cross. Nicodemus was there for the crucifixion. And in public, he took down the body of Jesus with Joseph of Arimathea. And the Bible says, and tradition teaches, that he was the one. Joseph gave the tomb. He gave the oils for the preparation of the body. The man who came to him at night saying, I don't know what to do. I want to follow you. I have my job. I have my reputation. I have my life as it is. I think it's enough. And yet here I am standing here finding you in the evening, so it's obviously not enough. Don't tell anybody, but it's not enough, or I wouldn't be here. And he finds the courage that even in the Gospels, at the trial of Jesus, if you read also Nicodemus, Nicodemus is the one that said Jesus has to be able to speak. He started advocating for him before he died. Nicodemus! So in the story today, he walks away. But don't think he never came back. He tried to defend him the night Jesus was taken, He took his body down that night, and he gave the oils to anoint his body. He became a disciple. There's actually churches to Nicodemus in the Holy Land. So here's the message. Be Nicodemus. You have seen some miracles in your life. I know you have. My seeing you in church, with our culture's interest in weekly attendance in church right now, you are the miracle I saw today. But is it enough? Remember, not all temptations are bad. And if today you're being tempted to go a little further, a little deeper, pray a prayer once a day for the next 5 days that say the name of God. What I do during Lent often is I take my watch off and I put it on my other hand on certain days. And it's so awkward whenever I feel it on the other arm, I say the Lord's Prayer. You know, or I pray for someone I know who's sick. I'm a little ADHD, so I need, like, reminders. So what will it be for you? Do you want to put a ring? You know, some of you, your rings don't fit at all. Others of you, they only fit on certain fingers, but maybe you can move a ring around. Wear a different piece of jewelry around your neck. Switch your watch. Those are ways in the darkness that you're going to sneak to say to Jesus, I'm ready to go just a little bit further, even if it means I have to change some things in my life. Start by changing your watch. That's not a big change. And know that although Lent is a period where Jesus is going into some pretty dark places, here's another spoiler alert. We know how Lent ends. Don't let anyone tell you don't follow Jesus through Lent. You know how this movie ends. Amen. Stand and affirm our faith. We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, but one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven. By the power of the Holy Spirit, he became incarnate from the Virgin Mary and was made man. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day, he rose again in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son. With the Father and the Son, he is worshipped and glorified. He has spoken to the prophets. We believe in one holy Catholic and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen.
Lord, preserve your church from all evil. May we who have been born of water and the Spirit proclaim the kingdom of God in all the world. And of the Diocesan Cycle of Prayer, we pray for Grace Church, Georgetown, and Grace Church, Silver Spring Parish. We give thanks for Dr. Lyons' presence and among us and ask that you would strengthen her with your grace. Lord, bless us.
So that we may bless others.
O God, may the leaders of the nations ever seek the truth, open their hearts to true conversion and divine guidance. Lord, bless us.
So that we may bless others.
On this first Sunday, we pray for our first responders,
Jimmy, Janet, Bush, James, Kenny, Pat, Alvaro, Connor, and Lulu.
Strengthen, uphold, and guard them through the changes and chances in this life. Lord, bless us.
So that we may bless others.
Maker of heaven and earth, you have blessed us with a wondrous and dynamic creation. Protect us from its rage. Comfort us by its tranquility. Give us eyes to see your handiwork in the world around us. Make us caregivers of your earth's healing. Lord, bless us.
So that we may bless others.
Lord, your eyes never close on your people. We thank you for your mindfulness of us and our community. Be our help and our safety. Lord, bless us.
So that we may bless others.
You did not send your Son into the world to condemn the world, but in order that the world may see and experience your salvation. Bring wholeness to those who look at your Son for their help. We lift up those on our prayer list.
Debbie, Marion, Anne, Tony, Drew, Lynn, Sally, Colleen, Dorothy, Gail, Wendy, Jan, Diane, Jack, Joyce, Lonnie, Barbara, Ed, Rogers, Dick, Vera, Betty, Larry, John, Tina, Sandy, Ed, Linda, John, Shelley, Barbara, Ray, John, Steve, and Anne.
Bless us, Lord.
So that we may bless others.
O God, who gives life to the dead and calls into existence the things that do not exist, keep the dying and the dead from this time forth and forevermore. Lord, bless us.
So that we may bless our sisters.
God, your word says that you know how many hairs are on our head and that your spirit will groan when we have not words for our pain and for our joy. Thank you. Thank you for listening to us. Thank you for giving us visions of a world healed, of sin forgiven, of darkness made light. And we ask all these things in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
And my friends, the peace of the Lord be with all of you always.
And also with you.
Mother Maria wanted us to continue with our Lenten conversation. So today you're being given a card, and this is a card that she would like you to take home. It has a question for every day, and I get to pick the question that I wanted to talk about, that I wanted you to talk about, and as it turns out, it goes perfectly with everything that's been going on today. So the idea, I'm an old school teacher, so the idea is we're going to think about it, then we're going to share it with someone else, and then we're going to take it a step further, and we're going to share it with another group. So we're going to think about it individually. We're going to talk to somebody sitting near us. Now, the danger in this is if you always sit with the same people, then you're going to always get the same opinion. So you might want to try to spread your wings a little bit. But we're gonna do this for about 4 minutes. But I don't have my watch. Do you have a watch? Anybody have a watch that you can? Okay. So the question that you're going to consider is the question for Wednesday, and it's, is it ever too late to begin again? I think about Abraham and Sarah, and the fact that they had a child when they were so young. So those are the kinds of things that I want you to pick one or two or three people to talk about for about 4 minutes, and then we'll share again. Okay, so you may begin. Thank you. We have about 10 more seconds. Okay, I could put up the quiet sign. So now what I want you to do is to have your group find another group and share what you talked about to each other. So this group had ideas that they can talk to this group. Okay, and we'll do that only for maybe 2 minutes. Okay, so you can begin.
Thank you.
I hope that you find these conversations a way to maybe get a new idea that you can take further, and that you can contemplate over the week. And I do hope that, I know that Mother Maria hopes that you use these cards throughout the week. On the back, there is a prayer that I would like to do. Creator God, sometimes I have to stop and think about it. What am I learning these days? What is my body trying to teach me? What is my soul yearning for? If I'm not careful, I could ignore life's lesson and simply carry on. But I want to do more than carry on. I want to grow. I want to learn. Help me learn.
Amen.
Thank you for your participation.
Give thanks to the Lord, for he is good. His mercies endure forever. Come into his courts with offerings, praise, and thanksgiving.
Thank you.
hearts.
We lift them up to God.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give God thanks and praise.
We thank you, Desert Mother, for in the valley of dry bones you create hearts of flesh quickened by the Spirit's breath. We thank you, wise sister, that you walk in cloud and fire with your lost and faithless people. We thank you, Son of Heaven, that you empty yourself of might and glory and set your face towards the fickle crowd, the cruel empire, the faithful despisers. We welcome you as God's own fool, whose cross brings to nothing the violence of the world and reveals another wisdom outside the city walls. Therefore, with all who follow your way, with the traitors and tax collectors, the soldiers and hurting women in the streets, and all who caught a glimpse of glory in the humanity you share, we worship God's own holiness revealed in sweat and tears. And said, "Take, eat, this is my body, broken for you. Do this in remembrance of me." We thank you. And after supper, Jesus took the cup of wine, said the blessing, and gave it to his friends and said, "Drink this, all of you. This is the cup of the new covenant of my blood, poured out for you and for all the forgiveness of sin. Do this for the remembrance of me." And so, remembering all that was done for us, the cross, the tomb, the resurrection, and ascension, longing for Christ's coming in glory, and presenting to you these gifts your earth has formed and human hands have made, we acclaim you, O Christ.
Dying, you destroyed our death. Rising, you restore our life. Christ Jesus, come in glory.
Send your Holy Spirit upon us and upon these gifts of bread and wine, that they may be to us the body and blood of your Christ. Grant that we, burning with your Spirit's power, may be a people of hope, justice, and love. Giver of life, draw us together in the body of Christ, and in the fullness of time, gather us with all your people into the joy of our true eternal home. Through Christ, and with Christ, and in Christ, by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, we worship you, our God and Creator, in voices of unending praise and worship. You, God and Creator, in voices of unending praise, blessed are you now and forever. Amen. Rejoicing in the presence of God here among us, as our Savior taught us, so we pray.
Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Save us from the time of trial, and deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen.
Behold who you are.
May we come what we receive.
Thank you.
Let us pray. Lord of this feast beyond measure in Christ, we thank you for meeting us in our brokenness so that none might be lost.
Liberate us now to share bread with our neighbor, each receiving from the other what we need to be ourselves. Amen.
Birthdays. Anybody this week? Last few days of the coming week? Anniversaries. Okay, good, because this morning, this is like going to be a holdover. We're going to repeat, even though he's not here. Jim is 95. He turned 95 on March 2nd. So I don't know if you all are familiar with him at the 8 o'clock, but they had a cake for him. Blue icing on everybody. Crazy party for the 95-year-old. Let's hope that comes online. All kinds of craziness. Singing, mirth was had by all. But his children were here. He has grandchildren. And he was making jokes. And was the only one not eating cake, which tells you something. But let's keep Jim in our prayers. A man whose life at 95 brought joy to a coffee hour and then the meeting about the fish fry. So God bless Jim, his devotion to God, to the many churches he's attended in 95 years. And we thank God for the gift of his life in this one. Please stand for the blessing. Let us know the good news.
First of all, I forgot this at 8 o'clock, but I want to say we're glad to have you with us today. The announcements are on page 18. There's two couple I'd like to highlight. The first one is the Winter Fruit Fundraiser that's still ongoing. You can find information about that in the midweek on our Facebook page. There's a board down in the Hamilton room. And if you still have questions after all that, you can talk to Jane Frew or Phil Hamilton. And if Mother Maria, if you're watching, normally when Maria's away, a lot of people play hooky. They showed up today, Mother Maria. So it's good to see you all. Oh, Timothy, yes. We have I don't know your last name, but Timothy is...
Timothy Cradle.
We're glad to have you here today with us.
Thank you.
Thanks.
One other thing I would like to highlight on, starting this Wednesday, we're going to have a series, Mother Maria will lead a series, Lenten series on different ways to connect with God. And it starts this Wednesday on Zoom. And the Wednesday nights will end with evening prayer. There's a link for that in the midweek. And then it'll also be in person on Sunday, starting next Sunday. So be sure to join us for that. And then I believe Frank wants to say something about the fish fry.
So the fish fry is coming up, and that's Friday, March 31st, from 4 to 7. We really need volunteers. So when you go down to coffee hour today, check out the bulletin board, see if there's a job there you could do. If not, we can show you how to do it. Our next meeting for Fish Fry will be Sunday, March 26th, down in the Hamilton room at 9:30. It's kind of the final meeting, kind of finalizing stuff. But if you have any questions at all, see Cheryl. No, see me. My email's down there. You can see Cheryl also or myself, and we'll be glad to answer any questions.
Just because there might be some confusion, we have the wrong number of the hymn in the bulletin. It was wrong on the board, but now it's fixed, and it's actually 473, not 437.
Please stand. My friends, life is short, and we do not have much.
us time to gladden the hearts of those who traveled the way with us. So be slow to anger, quick to love, and receive the blessings of God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. 473.